Spinal stenosis is usually a degenerative condition that tends to occur in the latter decades of life, but not universally so, that usually is caused by a combination of multifactorial degenerative changes, including disc protrusions and disc herniations, thickening or hypertrophy of facets, which are the joints of the spine, and thickening of the ligaments of the spine, and all of these factors together in combination, including bone spur formation, result in concentric narrowing of the space around the nerves in the spinal canal. The two areas that we most commonly treat is cervical spinal stenosis and lumbar spinal stenosis, that affecting the neck and the lower back. We often ask patients on a scale of 1 to 10, how bad is the pain? And many patients say 10 or 12, and this is really quite severe pain. The typical symptoms of lumbar spinal stenosis are usually twofold. Lumbar neurogenic claudication refers to a fairly debilitating cramping or tired pain feeling in the legs that usually develops with activity. So the typical patient will describe cramping pain in the backs of the thighs and the calves, sometimes in the buttocks, that is brought on by walking. The second major symptom of lumbar spinal stenosis is that of lumbar or lumbosacral radiculopathy. Radiculopathy refers to nerve impingement, and that usually causes either one-sided or two-sided bilateral radiating leg pain, what we call sciatica. And that pain is a fairly typical pain that originates in the buttock and radiates through the buttock down the leg to varying points near or into the foot, associated with a variable degree of tingling or numbness. In the cervical spine, it can cause compression of the spinal cord, which often causes profound neurological deficits, symptoms of weakness and paralysis, spasticity of gait, problems with balance and walking, tingling and numbness in the hands, weakness of the hands, profound difficulty with fine motor skills and manual dexterity of the hands. So patients often describe difficult changes in their handwriting, difficulty buttoning buttons or opening pill bottles. And again, all of these symptoms are related to dysfunction of the spinal cord. In most cases, spinal surgery is very effective at treating the underlying structural and mechanical cause of the problem and at alleviating pain. It's also very good at least arresting the progression of neurological symptoms, and in many cases can actually result in reversal of some neurological dysfunction. Our philosophy here at Tufts Medical Center within the Department of Neurosurgery and the Division of Spinal Surgery is we are really very, very conservative. We are not operate first, ask questions later surgeons. We view surgery as the option of last resort. We really take on the comprehensive multimodality treatment of patients with painful disorders of the neck and lower back, including the prescription of physiotherapy, including aquatic therapy, the performance of truncal calisthenics, abdominal and lower back and neck muscle stretching and strengthening exercises, and the very judicious use of pain management procedures, including the use of epidural steroid injections and nerve blocks. When surgery is deemed necessary, our surgeons here in our spinal division are really technically superb and very, very proficient, performing the latest surgical procedures through minimally invasive approaches. Our philosophy is to perform the least amount of surgery, the least intrusive surgery necessary to adequately treat the problem. I think the care that we provide to our spinal surgery patients is unparalleled, not only in New England, but also in the entire United States and world.